Welcome back once again to All Black Digital. My name is Carl Craig, and this is edition number 2 of our talks. Today we have the master of disaster, Mr. King Britt. you might know him from Philadelphia, but now he's doing next level stuff out west. King, great to see you, brother.
Carl, what's going on? Everyone, what's up? How are you here in San Diego? I'm at UCSD right now. I'm an assistant teaching professor here. So, yeah, man, new realms.
New realms. You know, from way back in the day to now, you know, we've known each other since 1991, basically.
91, man. It could be 92. Not 92, but 90 as well. But
it might be, It could be 92 when you got the record. But I think because Planet E came out in 91, that for Jazz Funk Classics. Okay. We're in the middle of 30 years of Planet E right now.
Yeah.
Which is great.
Oh, man. Congratulations.
Fantastic. Man. Yeah. You know, I mean, long road.
Seriously. Like, in the new record, the Francisco's record, like, you just keep the consistency over the 30 plus years is just phenomenal, man.
Right. Thank you very much, man. You've been in this game for, actually, you've been in this game for longer than I have. You've been DJing for longer than I have. Yeah. You've been making records for longer than I have, I think.
Just by a few years, yeah.
Yeah. So this, you know, the longevity is amazing. So how has it been for you over these years, and especially, you know, going into what you're doing right now in the academia? You know, I mean, that shift is a great shift, you know?
Well, you know, thanks for the question. Like, you know how we do. So when we first started out, and I'm including all of us, when we first started out, you know, late 80s, maybe mid 80s, but let's just say late 80s, you know, it was new frontier for us. We got these new instruments and there was community around it. And, you know, then we started to travel a little bit, you know, and going from bedroom and these mixtapes and kind of demos. So if you look at the journey, like, it's always been this every step was a new discovery, because we're always students, right? We're always trying to push not only sound, but also, like, we want to always learn more, you know. And for me, I'm only child. A lot of times I get bored quickly, and so I'm constantly, maybe not buying new gear, but thinking of new ways to use the gear that I have. Or, you know, maybe I'll get more into film for a while, then come back to the music. You know what I mean? So there's always this yearning for discovery, you know? And I think I can speak for you, seeing the same way. I mean, I hear it musically in your music and in your curation, as far as the label and also your exhibitions. And so we're always just rising to the top, looking for new frontiers to dive into. And, you know, the whole DJ world when we started was just kind of, it was more insular. And now it's like, you know, my mom is DJing. You know what I mean? Like, everybody's DJing.
Yeah.
Everyone's got a controller. Everyone has access. I mean, we're talking now in Beatport, for Beatport, which has every track you could think of every week. Back in the day, we had to stand in line, maybe, because only 3 are coming in. Or if we're in Japan, it's only in Japan. And now the internet, we can get anything at any time. So, you know, there's always that, okay, what's the next? How can we make DJing, you know, how can we maintain the excitement for ourselves within it? And, you know, I look at Francois as he's one of my heroes, and just seeing him and one of my mentors And you too, I think, because I think you guys just
I love Francois.
The way he just keeps growing, and he has all these, you know, he's making these multi-track stems of things and then dubbing them out. So it's doing really what he was doing in the studio, he's doing live right in front of you. And he feel, when you talk to him, it's like he's a little kid again. You know, it's like he's just so amped. And I think that's what keeps us going. And so pivoting into academia, you know, this came at a time where I had no idea. Like, a friend of a friend said, there's a position, you would be perfect. And then the young lady I was dating at the time, she was like, and she's in academia, she's like, you should fill that paperwork out. And I was like, eh. And she's like, well, it'll be a way for you to see all your accomplishments in one place, which I had never really done, you know? And so it took 3 weeks. The CV is like 40 pages. It was crazy, right?
Wow.
You know, just like you, if you did your CV, like, come on, bro, it would be insane, right? And so then you see it, and then you say, wow, maybe I can get this job. You know, I try not to look at it as a job. I look at it as an extension of what we do already, but now we're giving back.
Mm-hmm.
Now, dude, like, all my students, you know, showing them compression today, you know, it's just mind blowing. And then they say, well, we use it this way.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, yo, yeah. And, you know, and so I'm learning from them because they're using it in a way that we may not have thought of, you know? And so hopefully this is answering your question, and I'll make it shorter. Just the yearning for discovery and being flexible and open, right? If I wasn't open to the idea of being a professor, it wouldn't have happened.
Mm-hmm.
And also, you know, my ex-lady, her push. You know, we always have people in our circle that push us to be better, you know, and it could be unspoken. You know, you could put out a track and I'm like, this guy, all right, let me get in the studio, man.
Mm-hmm.
This guy called Craig, man. I got an arpeggiator too. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. That's how it should be. It should be,
yes, exactly.
You know, music is definitely a conversation. Music should be where you find your inspiration from, places where you're not necessarily looking for it from. It should be surprising. It should always be that thing. And, you know, with what you're doing out in San Diego, that this is similar to what the jazz guys, you know, have been doing for decades. You know, Marcus Belgrave, he was teaching at Oberlin.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, and what, like, Marcus is always a mentor to the younger generation. He always found it that you know, I think that it wasn't only necessary for him to be that, but it was something that fulfilled him to always be around the younger generation. So he always pulled from the pool of young guys that he was teaching as well to do gigs. So I remember him coming to Detroit with his Oberlin crew, and, you know, they were bad, man. They were real bad. Francisco Mora is the same way when he was working at MSU.
Yeah.
And, you know, he did, I don't know how many years he did that at MSU, whether it was a decade or under a decade.
Seven, I think.
Was it 7 years? And then Rodney Whitaker took over from him. And, you know, so it's great that now this is the case of electronic music with what you're doing, you know, because I really feel that people take electronic music for granted because it comes into that realm of, you know, like with DJs, people have this idiotic belief that DJs aren't musicians, that they're only playing other people's music.
Right.
You know, and for certain, if you're listening to a DJ on the radio, he's just playing a playlist, yes.
Yes.
But there's no improvisation that's going on in relation to that. And, you know, even to be a DJ on the radio in the old days, when you put your own playlist together, that there's something that's really skillful about doing that, you know, because there's a certain time that you know that a record's going to work, or that people you know, want to hear that record at that time. And then there's some things that you want to play because they have to hear it. Exactly. You know?
Yeah.
So, you know, like breaking a new track or something.
Right. How did you, how did Mojo influence you?
Mojo. It's funny. Stacey Pullen has sent me a video. I'll send it to you, but he sent me this video of Mojo, Mojo show from, I think, 82. And, you know, Mojo used to start with music from Star Wars.
We were just talking about Jeff Mills was saying that. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So he,
John Williams. Yeah.
He was starting out with pieces from Star Wars, and he did that for years. It wasn't only when Star Wars came out in 77 or 78, he was doing that for years. And he would move through this arrangement of music. And then he'd get into the meat and potatoes of whatever he was going to play. This video has him starting out with this psychedelic break from Jimi Hendrix.
Really?
And it's like, when I heard it, it's like, God damn, this is, I mean, it was just amazing to hear this. And then he goes into this, I can't remember what the second track is that he goes into, but it's, he makes it like an interlude, and then he plays the edit that Derek and Juan did of Mesopotamia. And is
he was telling, he's a storyteller.
Yes.
And the thing with us, you know, we're as DJs, we're always, even if it's not that type of gig, we're always going to be storytellers through the selection.
Yes, definitely.
And
definitely.
That's what separates a lot of the DJs that just play the top 10 or whatever, top 50 tracks.
Yeah.
And they're in it for the fame and money versus the storytellers.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a thing, and I don't know if you've thought about it or if there's been a discussion about it. So, okay. The theory part of electronic music, the music theory part that comes into the arrangement aspect of it. And of course you have guys like Sasha that were known for playing music in keys and then would play based around, you know, the energy level of a key that he would modulate to, however he would do that. So the Camelot wheel thing now that we know about from, I forgot what the program's called.
Made in key or?
Yes. Hooked on Phonics. So, some DJs you can tell, like, they have theory. They have theory behind them and how they play. And so the theory aspect of it, like some DJs, their composition of their set, to me, can sound like how a Broadway play is put together.
Yes.
You know, so there's a science to how, you know, the arrangement of the music, that when it comes, the ebbs and flows, everything like that. And, you know, not only do we have, you know, friends that are from around the United States in different cities, but we have friends and colleagues from all over the world.
All over.
So, you know, the theory that comes into a Japanese DJ putting his set together, you know, is of course going to come from the folk background that is from Japanese music, from the influences of modern music. And then of course the Japanese, at one time it was Larry Levan, Francois K, you know, it was all these guys, Jeff Mills, it was all these guys that they were inspired by. So you could hear that in how they played, you
Absolutely.
Know? other DJs like, you know, Solomon, for instance, that's a really big name, you know, or like when I do a back to back with Luciano, I can hear, you know, where he's coming from in relation to his, you know, the backbeat, you know, how he puts the music together. What's your ideas about this?
I mean, this is fascinating that you're talking about it because, well, for the audience, I have a course called Blacktronica, Afrofuturism and Electronic Music. So we've had Carl in class.
I've been there. My pleasure.
And thank you. And what we do, we pay homage to all the innovators of color who have contributed to the advancement of electronic music, right? And most of the genres that we discuss, dub, drum and bass, Chicago house, Detroit techno, it's all coming from black music and black people. Yes. And then of course, it's open for everyone, but the root of it is coming from that canon, from that lineage. And so when talking about the lineage of these different genres, you know, you're starting to hear, you know, what came before that too, you know? So when you listen to drum and bass, before that was dub, and then you're hearing all the Jamaican influences in that. And then if you're listening to house, you're hearing gospel, you know, you're hearing blues. In fact, you're hearing, sometimes you're hearing classical, especially with techno, Detroit techno, because Jeff was saying yesterday that, you know, they listened to a lot of John Williams, and everyone was always thinking about strings, you know. We can talk about Derek, Strings of Life, come on. And so strings always were in there. And then in Philly, the Sound of Philadelphia, 70s, Gamelin Huff, all the string players in the Philadelphia Orchestra would moonlight and do these gigs. So we were coming up at a time where all these different influences were coming out of black music. Now, when you talk about DJing, and also I want to throw in there composing with electronic music, because, you know, in the beginning, a lot of musicians were like, you guys are just pressing buttons, or, you know, you're not creating music, you're just sampling. We talk about sampling, you're just stealing other people's music. But there is an art to it, which, of course, we can talk about Jay Dilla. I mean, there's so many. Mm-hmm. Public Enemy, of course.
Oh, yeah.
Now, the early days of sampling, and this is something I talked to Hank Shockley about. For those who don't know, Hank Shockley was producer of Public Enemy. He and Keith Shockley.
Mm-hmm.
But what it was is they were sampling, but you didn't have the capabilities to put things in key and still keep the tempo, right? And so certain things were dissonant, but that's what made it raw. That's what made it great, right? And if you listen to a lot of early jazz, there's a, you know, you listen to Sun Ra, let's just say, lots of dissonance, right?
Sure.
And there's a magic to dissonance, you know? You can't be afraid of it. Mm-hmm. Not everything is going to be harmonious, yeah? Mm-hmm. Now, I said to Hank, I was like, if you were to do a Public Enemy album now, with Ableton, right? So in Ableton, you can put things in key and you can also keep it in the tempo. So, you know, everything can be harmonious together. And he's like, it wouldn't sound the same because there was this push and pull. You know, it wasn't perfect. You know, the sequencing wasn't perfect. The keys weren't perfect. And that's what made those records. Mm-hmm. You know, DJ Shadow as well. And so when it comes to DJing, and putting things in key, I kind of like when you know there's a certain parts of it that's dissonant, you know? Because back in the day with vinyl, you know, you had to get the tempos. It wasn't about so much the keys. And sometimes the keys would kind of take you, if you were trying to put everything in key by your knowledge or your ear, it would kind of take you out. There were certain decisions that might take you out of the storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes, and also life isn't always harmonious.
No, not at all.
Especially coming from, I'm from Philly, you're from Detroit. You know, a lot of this music's coming from this energy. It's not harmonious, you know? So I embrace the dissonance, you know, and I feel, yes, what you said is completely true. Certain DJs that have everything in key, it can be absolutely mind-blowing, right? But sometimes it's just I'm missing that dissonance and that grit.
Yeah, that's why when I play, I usually don't use the key,
Oh,
the
no.
key correct or whatever.
Oh, you mean like on a CDJ or whatever?
Yeah, you know, where it
Oh,
keeps it
cool.
in pitch and stuff. I usually don't use that. And I don't use it because I don't like hearing the processing, because you could hear the processing, like especially on bass. And that thing has become kind of popular with the younger generation of people playing bass music or people playing rap music and trap, especially on the radio here, where you can hear when the bass comes in, it's go boo 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 boo, you know, it does this kind of gargling thing. And you know, it's something as a producer, I'm like, you know, you're just screwing it up, you know. But I get it why the younger generation would grab onto it, because they think that's the way it's supposed to be, that is correct. And that's maybe another thing that's a different dissonant thing that I can't get with. But you know, the next generation after me are looking at it, and they're saying that is really great. And then also one last thing about that is that the going back to Africa,
Come on, man.
going back to you know, voodoo, going to all that thing, they don't sit around and tune drums. You know what I'm saying? They're not tuning drums. They're not sitting there with a key and, you know, okay, let's see that we're getting in C. You know, no, it's none of that. It's just you're picking up what you're playing, and it becomes what it becomes. You know, whether you go to Cuba and they're using car parts as the clave or you know whatever. I'm sure I don't know enough about Haiti to know to talk about what they're doing with their voodoo down there. But you know, those along with the voices, because the voices aren't always going to be able to be in tune with the, you know, that difference in sound between the what makes up the rhythm section.
Absolutely. Yeah,
Yeah.
100%, man. And it's funny to hear like Western, like coming out of Western society, especially classical
Yeah.
and kind of experimental, coming out of classical, like, you know, the more experimental classical musicians trying to, you know, take certain compositions from Africa and then bring them into that world, but it sounds so they never get it because it you can't there's no tuning like that. You can't tune those instruments the way they did it in Africa. It's just not it's just not gonna happen. And it's always something missing, you know, there's always that element. So yeah, I appreciate that conversation on that. Yeah,
That
that's
reminds me of Yusuf Lateef. And yeah, you know, I'm always glad to speak of this stuff. And you know, it's a conversation that needs to be had about, you know, the theory that goes behind music, you know, that most people don't think of. They just think, okay, you're putting on a track, and then, you know, I put my hands up in the air, and it's got to have a break, and it's got to have this, and it's got to have that, whatever. But Yusuf Lateef played with the DSO here, and you know, when he did theme from Spartacus, all that kind of stuff, you know, just him playing alone with the orchestra, it's amazing. Just they knew how to do it. But he had something called the African Suite that he did with members of his band and then some members of the orchestra. And he was using the percussion players from the orchestra, so you know, bass drum, snare, et cetera, et cetera. And you know, it could not lock. It was not destined to lock, because you have people playing on the swing, but the orchestra is playing regimented.
Yeah.
And it was just a clash of sound, and it wasn't a clash like Sunrise Clash. Sunrise Clash has something there, you know. Yeah. This was just an unfortunate clash that came together, and it was great because they had a black conductor as well of the DSO at the time.
Wow.
But it didn't come together for the second part. The first part was amazing. The second part just didn't come together.
Interesting, man. Mm-hmm. I would have loved to see that, you know.
Yeah, probably I was
on. It might be someone. YouTube's got everything, man.
Goddamn, man. Yeah. You know, I was watching that Hugh Hefner thing.
Yo, everyone's telling me to watch this, man.
Yeah, and he's they're talking about how Hugh tried to record everything, and you know, he would actually say that he wasn't recording, but he was recording, and it's kind of like YouTube seems that there's like these unearthed videos of everything, you know? It's like, it could be somebody drinking a Mountain Dew in the alley and shaking hands with a rat. And somehow it's going to end up on YouTube.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. It's really something else, man. YouTube.
Yeah. So tell me something more about the Afrofuturism.
You mean the class or
just about your views in relation to that, you know?
Okay. Yeah. Well, just for the audience, you know, just who don't know what Afrofuturism the term is, it was a term that was coined by Mark Derry in 93, but actually the Flame Wars, which was where the term was written, and it was an interview with Greg Tate, Dr. Tricia Rose, and Samuel Delaney, and Mark Derry, and that's the first time the word was used ever. But the pamphlet or the paper didn't come out till 94, so people say 94, but it was really 93. And so what Afrofuturism is, which is a very strong word, it feels good to say. There's a lot of power in the word. But it's the cultural intersection of philosophy, technology, science fiction, and the music of the African diaspora through a lens to envision new black futures, right? So it was a way to look at our people in the future, you know, because a lot of times in these science fiction movies and television or whatever, you don't see ourselves in the future. Well, you do now, but at that time, mm-hmm. it wasn't as common.
Yeah.
And so, you know, this whole idea of it using that intersection to change how we look at the future and how we act on changing the future, right? And so, even before the term, you, me, all of us, we've been doing this, right? Like my parents, my mom was into jazz and vocals and New Sun Ra. My dad is in the funk, you know, and if you look at all the music that we came up with, Herbie Hancock, Sun Ra, like, you know, vocalist Abby Lincoln, Thelonious Monk, Alice Coltrane, all very futuristic
mm-hmm.
at all times. They were always looking beyond what was in front of them. Yeah. But always carrying the energy, ancestral energy with them. Right. And so, you know, even before the term, we've been doing this. This is just part of us. And as black people, especially in America, you know, we had to make do with a lot of things, and out of that urgency came innovation, you know. And if we want to just keep it with music, I mean, let's look at the turntable. The turntable is an instrument. Come on.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's crazy, you know. No one would have thought of that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And turntablism now is like it's like a sport. It should be in the Olympics. You know what I mean? But, you know, this urgency has always created this innovation and pushed us forward. So we've always been at the forefront of innovative things, dance, you know, technologies, the first cell phone. It's all from Black people, man. So anyway, as far as the class, that's, you know, the kind of basis for the class for on a music front, but also like the festival that you're going to be playing. I don't know when this is airing, but
before that. Yeah, definitely.
Okay, cool. That's the only show that I actually can go to.
Oh, wow.
Like I help curate the whole thing, but I have class and I'm still a little wary of Omicron or whatever is out there now.
Yeah.
And so I don't want to get my students sick.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I've seen everyone, whatever, but I have never seen the synthesizer orchestra that you have.
You're in for some donuts.
So I'm flying. Yo, man, I'm flying in. I can't wait. It's
beautiful.
Great.
Yeah. Thanks for having us. It's amazing.
Come on.
It's amazing. What King's talking about is Carnegie Hall, which is amazing to be invited, not only because it's King, but also the sugar on top is that it's at Carnegie and the brothers are going to take it over. The brothers is going to take it over.
Yes.
So, when George Clinton was doing Mothership Connection,
come on.
Was that like your first, your first feeling of Afrofuturism or your first view of what Afrofuturism is, or was it Sun Ra?
It was Sun Ra, musically Sun Ra, right. Because luckily my mom knew him. So I went to rehearsals quite often for the orchestra. And it's funny because I had Marshall in. I had the orchestra in Blacktronica, and he remembered my mom, like who she was. And but when I was a kid, I mean, I used to cover my ears, man. I couldn't take it.
Yeah.
I didn't understand it.
Right.
But I was always fascinated by the costumes, you know. Even when they were rehearsing, they had garb on. They lived in the future. They lived it.
Yeah.
And so that was my first, musically, my first, you know, group, like, wow, they are really, they're not from here. But on TV, the first was Uhura from Star Trek.
Okay.
You know, so to see a Black woman at the forefront, you know, helping right on the starboard, like, you know, right next to William Shatner, like the captain. It was powerful to see that, because that's the science fiction before that, no Black people. That was the first for me to see. And then of course all the Japanese shows, Johnny Sacco, Flying Robot, and Ultraman. You know, I say to my class, like, I don't know how our channels like got those, you know, those TV shows, but thank God, because that was like, whoa, you know.
Yeah, that's the same for us, that we had, you know, Giant Robot was my boy. That was that was Giant Robot Launch.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, you know, I have a older brother and older sister.
Oh, okay, I didn't know.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. And my brother and I have about 9 years between us. Okay. And he used to bring in, that was where I got my music from. So my mother was always complaining that she wanted me to listen to Alvin and Chipmunks when my brother would be bringing in, you know, rock records and funk records and all these things. And, you know, at the time it was the album covers that were that play with your imagination, and the album covers were always the portal to the music.
Yes, yes.
You know, and Like one of the, there were a couple of the first albums that kind of freaked me out was like Black Sabbath, Sabbath Bloody Sabbath, and then there was Elton John, Adventures of Captain Fantastic, right? So, of course, in the world of black music, you know, if you look at the covers of Funkadelic or Ohio Players or any of that kind of stuff, which are amazing.
Bitches Brew,
right. Bitches, Jesus, there you go, right there. That was probably, you know, from my recollection, that might be the first of its kind to come into this world. And you know, then Mothership Connection, you know, where, you know, brothers in space or brothers coming out from a spaceship, that kind
with
of
thing diapers
was, huh,
with diapers on,
with diapers, yeah. You know, that was where I was seeing Afrofuturism without even knowing anything about it.
Yeah.
But where it really came into play for me was hanging out at Derek May's loft.
Oh man.
And you know, it was, we would sit on the floor with the synthesizers all around us and talk about making music for Blade Runner, you know.
Totally, yes.
We would look at these graphic novels of Rank Xerox and you know, Arkham Asylum, you know, when Frank Miller took over the Batman stuff. Yeah. We were really looking at this stuff and visualizing it to put it into the music. And, you know, his influence from that, of course, came from Juan and what Rick were doing with Cybertron and, you know, the name Cybertron that comes from, hold on, Alvin Toffler.
Oh, right.
The third wave, yes. You know, the whole concept of Metroplex and what became Metroplex Records and everything comes from the influence of Alvin Toffler. And, you know, that was important to make the music. And I think as, you know, the legend had kind of made his way, you know, the interviews that were being done with Derek, Kevin, and Juan and all that was coming in. You saw that legend that came into what Detroit techno is.
Yeah.
And, but, you know, it goes back before Detroit techno, of course, again, on the musical side, not only with Sun Ra, but, you know, maybe Sun Ra actually is the starting point. Sun Ra may have been the first guy to use synthesizer in black music.
He was definitely the first to use it in jazz. And I think you're right, because there were only two mini Moog B's made. So Bob Moog had one, and then he called Sun Ra and the whole orchestra went to the factory to pick this up.
Right.
So yeah, because no one else had it but him, you know, as far as the mini Moog. Now, I've been trying to do research to see who else came before him that was black.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I haven't found anyone. So yeah,
that's Motown had a synthesizer.
But it came later.
I'm not sure when it came, but they had
Tonto. So there's Tonto, which was on all of Stevie Wonder records.
Yes.
So Malcolm Cecil and all. You can go see Tonto. It's up in Canada.
Yeah.
Alberta, right? But after that, there was Raymond Scott.
Yes.
Right? Raymond Scott created this special synthesizer that Mark Mothersburg has now. He bought the original, restored it. But what it was, it made tracks. Like, you didn't need musicians. You fed in information and it actually made rhythm tracks.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But you needed Raymond to run it. So Raymond ran it for a while, and then I don't know whatever happened, but yeah. But that came, I think that was like 78 or 9. It might even been later. It might have been like 81 or so.
Right. Raymond Scott was doing like IBM commercials and all that stuff. Yeah. But I think he was, it might have been in the late 60s or 70s when he was doing that stuff, right?
Raymond, or was it even before 50s?
That? It was the 50s that he was doing that. Yeah. Wow.
And his, yeah, the guy that runs his whole estate lives in Philly.
Oh, right. Okay.
Jeff. Yeah, his name's Jeff. Yeah.
Cause
Dilla. Dilla, man.
Dilla, exactly. Lightworks, right? Yeah. That's the one they sampled.
Yeah.
Which is incredible.
It's insane.
So Black music, you know, with the Stones, with Pink Floyd, with the Who, all those guys getting synthesizers.
Oh, right.
Know.
Yes. And Paul McCartney.
Paul McCartney. Yeah, they were doing all the tape loops, yeah, and stuff like for Tomorrow Never Knows and all that, that went into what McCartney was doing in his solo works and stuff.
Yes, exactly.
You know, brothers always want to be on the next.
Right.
Right. It's always the next. So Amp always talks about that, where he talks about the next,
the next.
And with Black music, when the synthesizer came in, actually, maybe it was the drum machine, because it was Sly Stone that was using the Ace Tone, yeah, which George Clinton called the Funk Box.
Yes.
And that's what I call all my drum machines now, Funk Box. Pass me the Funk Box. Where's the Funk Box at? So every drum machine is a Funk Box to me now. And so that, there's Riot Going On, which is all the way through the whole album. And it's sweet because, you know, he has a drummer playing with it as well.
Right.
And the drummer is locked. And Francisco talks about Sun Ra telling him, hey, you know, you gotta put, this is the future. You gotta learn how to play with this thing, you know?
Yeah.
And so it was, of course, the Funk Box. And then when the synthesizer started coming in with Stevie making the synth a very integral part of his music, Herbie making, you know, hooking up with Dr. Philip Gleason, as they called him. I don't know if he's really a doctor or not, but, you know, Patrick Gleason, rather, Patrick, not Philip. Yeah. Dr. Patrick Gleason. You know, it definitely opened that world within Black music where it's like, okay, you have to have a synth. Oh, yeah. And as time went on, you know, where when the M1 became a big thing, when the DX became big, when the D50, when all these things, you know, you heard it all over Black music. It was just all over it, you know? And, but before that, funk bands had to have a synth in it, you know?
Exactly.
Of course, with George Clinton and all those guys, sorry.
No, I was just going to say a little side note that's super important, and I'm glad he's getting his flowers now, is Don Lewis.
Mm-hmm.
Don Lewis was, you know, I had him in class as well, but recently he's been on the Mark Ronson series that's on Apple Music, and it was beautiful to see, like, yo, he's getting his props.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Don Lewis was, you know, he grew up in the church, and then he started working for the military at Area 51.
Okay.
And so he was working at Area 51, but he always was doing music, you know, playing piano and keys. And he met his wife that he's still with now. And he's like, I want to move west. I want to work with Quincy Jones. Like, mm-hmm, that was his goal.
Mm-hmm.
He moved to California, and he worked with Quincy. But before that, he had opened for the Beach Boys.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So he was touring with Beach Boys a little bit. And then in between the Beach Boys and, like, working with Quincy, he was doing, like, this, I guess he had a lounge gig in L.A. or whatever. And so the owner of Roland, Ikatore, went and he saw Don Lewis. Now Don Lewis invented this thing called the Leo, and it's like a multi-synthesizer, like it's huge. It's in the museum here, right outside of San Diego. This large synthesizer, it has all these modules from different other synthesizers, right? But anyway, it was the early iteration of that. I'm trying to be quick about it. I see your face. But, you know, long story short, he had hacked the rhythm ace, right? Mm-hmm. The ace tone, yeah, rhythm ace. He hacked it so he could program it.
Uh-huh.
Because he's an engineer.
Right.
Working, you know, Area 51. So he opened it, he made it. And that's where Ikatori was like, oh my God, you made it so you can program. And then the one came out where you could program, which mm-hmm. came a little bit later. And then he brought Don in to work on the 808.
Mm-hmm.
And then Don worked on all the DX7 sounds. Mm-hmm. So it's Don is, you know, a black man responsible mm-hmm. for actually all of these sounds that you're talking about. Sly Stone, all the 80s using the DX. He made those sounds.
I mean, that's amazing.
It's crazy, dude.
You know, it makes sense about the 808 because yeah. of the low end of the kick drum that a black man would have something to do with it. You know, it makes total sense that it's like, okay, we got to put some ass in this, you know?
Exactly.
You know, there got to be some ass in this, man. And it's crazy because one of, you know, a record that was huge for us here in Detroit, Computer World.
Oh, my. Yeah.
Had the potential of having the ass in it, but they never used it.
They didn't put it in there, man.
They didn't put it in.
And it's still a great, incredible song. But
yeah. Sherrard Ingram, DJ Stingray from here.
Oh. He's incredible, yeah.
I've known Sherrard from, you know, before I met Kevin and Derek and those guys. I knew Sherrard before. He used to work at a record store. And we would go into the store and just talk. We'd just be talking. He'd be behind the counter. And you know, I think he liked Kevin's tracks better and I like Derek's tracks better. So we were just, you know, back and forth. Oh, yeah, that track that Kevin did, that track that Derek. No, that one I like better than this one, blah, blah, blah. And it always, and I try to say this as much as I can, he said, and this was back in, you know, 1987, 86, 87, he said, man, the 808 is the future.
he deserves all the props for that statement.
He nailed it, for real. Yeah. I mean, the 808, he heard it back then. The 808 is the future, and the 808 ain't go nowhere. The 808 is still around and it's still going into the future, you know?
Exactly.
I mean, people refer to sine waves as 808.
Right. Exactly. It's funny because all my students, that's what they really didn't know that it's actually a drum machine.
Yeah.
They just know, you know, the low sine wave sound. And they all have the samples and all, but now they know, oh, this is an actual machine, like,
yeah,
physical. It's wild, man. And I regret selling my
well, let's not leave on regrets, but I think the 808 was a good time to yes. To leave this. Thank you, my brother. It's been beautiful honor, to have you, man.
Honor, bro, like
as always.
Yeah. And I'll see you in March.
Yeah, I'll see you in March and at Carnegie Hall.
Yes.
It's going to be amazing. Again, thanks for the invite. It's going to be dope. We have, you know, Ian Fink and John Dixon.
Ian played here at school.
Yeah.
With Shigeto. I brought Shigeto here.
Yes, he plays with Shigeto. Yeah.
It was incredible, man.
Yeah. Ian is bad, man. Ian is bad. When he does, I think he uses a bass synth on one hand and he plays the Rhodes on the other. It's just banging.
It's like Herbie.
So Ian, John Dixon.
Okay.
Oh. We have Kelvin Scholler, who is
Calvin Scholler. Calvin
is my we were born on the same day. That's my brother,
really?
My dear twin brother in music. Oh. He's the man. Actually, we met the first time playing on Francisco's gig with Marshall Allen at North Sea Jazz Festival. Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah. That's first time we met. So anyway, thanks, King, man. This has been dope.
Yes.
All Black Digital.
You got dinner to make.
I got dinner to make. That's right. All right, my brother.